So good morning once again to all the participants, and this is day three of our Atal FDP. So the first speaker for the day is Dr. Shailesh Kumar. Sir is working as staff scientist 3 in the bioinformatics laboratory at National Institute of Plant Genomic Research in New Delhi. His research areas includes bioinformatics, genomics, big data analysis, machine learning, deep learning, artificial intelligence, and plant biotechnology. He had received various scientific contributions or recognitions, like he was selected for the Sakura Exchange Program in Science for Indian Young Officers, Japan, by the Department of Biotechnology back in 2018. He was a visiting faculty in Guangxi Medical University and Guilin Medical University, China. That was in 2017. He is related to the Journal of Translational Medicine and BMC Bioinformatics. He is reviewers of various journals like PLOS One, BMC Genomics, Bioinformatics, BMC Biology. Lot many are there. And his research areas, the research interests basically includes titles like identification of and characterization of novel molecules in plants, the development of web servers, databases, and computational pipelines for plant research, plant biotechnology. And there is again a big list of different databases and tools that he had developed or contributed, like MetroPB, tncRNA, ptRNA-DB. And the list you can see, I'll be sharing a profile of Sir. There is a big list. And there are again a lot of publications which Sir had published in reputed national and international journals. So there is this topic on which Sir will be speaking on, that is the role of next generation sequencing data sets in genomic search. So I'm really grateful to you, Sir, for accepting my invitation. And I really look forward for your talk. And I hope the participants will get good knowledge about next generation sequencing. We were going through different topics of discussion on computer-aided drug design related to molecular docking and all for the last 2 days. And I hope so this topic will add knowledge to all those topics. So over to you, sir. You can take the session now. Thank you, sir.
All right. So thank you, Dr. Roma, for this nice introduction. And thanks for the inviting me for this lecture series. So let me share my screen. So am I audible? Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
All right. So
the questions at the last of the session, you can just continue with the talk, and at the last we'll be taking the questions from the audience.
Great. Okay. Great. So today I will be talking about the role of next generation sequencing data sets in genomics research. So basically I was I'm dealing with this next generation sequencing data sets since 2009, basically, when I started my PhD at Institute of Microbial Technology, Chandigarh. So when I was there, then I start learning about these technologies, you know, next generation sequencing technologies. The wet lab scientists sequence the data set, the microbes, basically, the fungal genomes, microbial genomes. And at that time, these technologies were very new, you know. And Illumina, ABI Solid, Roche 454, Ion Torrent, Telescope. So this Illumina, ABI Solid, and Roche 454 are old technologies. And ABI Solid and Roche 454 is they are now obsolete, basically. So people are not using these technologies right now, ABI Solid and Roche 454. But you can always find the data sets, the raw the next generation sequencing data set at NCBI SRA, that I'll be showing you. And of course, this Heliscope, PacBio, Nanopore are the latest platforms, and Ion Torrent also. So, and Illumina is was the major player there at the time in 2007, 8, 9, and it's still there, you know. At that time, actually, Illumina was Solexa, you know, and Illumina platform was producing 36 nucleotide length reads, short reads, and now Illumina is producing, more than a kb reads basically. So people are using because these sequencing technologies as compared to Sanger sequencing reduce high throughput data in low cost and very less time as compared to Sanger sequencing. And if you see this graph, basically, this is the at x-axis we have years, 2009, 2010, 11, 12, and till 2018. And at y-axis, we have the size, basically size of the bases in terabases, basically, at NCBI SRA. SRA is Short Read Archive of USA. If you Google it, NCBI SRA, then you will find. So you can see in 2009, the size of terabases of the data was there, like 1 or 2 terabases, okay? And now in 2018 and now 21, it is like increasing with the high rate. So it means people are sensing the genomes, transcriptomes, you know, exomes and ChIP-seq, all those things, you know, people are, scientists are doing and depositing data at NCBI SRA. And of course, they are utilizing these technologies, next generation sequencing technologies, for their own purpose. Like that can be a transcriptome sequencing, that can be a variation calling, you know, that can be whole genome sequencing, resequencing, de novo, you know. So I'll start with, you know, so since, as I told you, I am working since 2009. So I'll be talking about the whole genome assembly annotation, some exome sequencing analysis, transcriptome sequencing, and of course the non-coding RNA identification, all those things, you know, and different in different systems like plants, animals, bacteria, I was dealing with. So let's start with, you know, at the time when I started the PhD in 2009. So, you know, I was at like Institute of Microbial Technology. So they were dealing with microbes, and I was doing PhD in bioinformatics. So they said, okay, so why don't you start learning this whole genome assembly and annotation with the next generation sequencing data sets? So this is a pipeline actually, like microbial genome assembly and annotation. Suppose, before that, this is easy slide actually, easy to understand. Like suppose we have a microbe and suppose we sequence that microbial genome with Illumina or 454, then we will get the reads basically, short reads. And then we have to assemble those short reads into the contigs, long chunks of nucleotide, contiguous sequences. And of course, we have, whether it's Illumina data, 4-5 data, 4-5-4 data, ion torrent data, or PacBio, Nanopore, Helloscope, any platform, we have the assemblers, a different type of assemblers with different type of data sets, okay? So we have genome assemblers like Velvet, SOAP, de novo. These are for Illumina data basically. And we have to convert those short reads into the contigs, and of course contigs into the scaffolds. Scaffolds are like the joining of contigs by putting N between the contigs. It means this is a strategy to assemble the contigs by putting N. N means any nucleotide. Actually, we can convert those contigs, we can join those contigs into the scaffolds on the basis of the paired and read information, you know, and by putting Ns basically. And we don't know actually these, is it A, it is A, G, T, or C. And then, of course, we have to annotate these scaffolds. And here we have also annotation servers and manual annotation we can perform with different web servers or pipelines, like here, RAST server, PGAP, CAS, etc. And then we will get the annotation, annotated genome, and of course we can study. So now again, come to the pipeline. Like suppose we sequence the microbial genome, then first step is the quality check, removal of low quality bases, removal of read containing adapter sequences, trim or remove the reads that contains N. So actually what happened when these sequencers sequence the genome or transcriptome, some low quality bases will be incorporated in these sequencing reads, and then we have to remove those low quality bases to improve the quality of our raw data. Raw data means reads. You know, as I said, these sequencers produce the reads, short reads. And then we have to trim to remove the N. N means, as I said, any nucleotide. If N is present in the three prime end of the reads, then we have to remove, or five prime end of the reads, then we have to remove those Ns. And of course, then we have to assemble the genome into contigs. If we have the genome assembly, if we have the reference genome selection, if we have reference genome, then we have to perform the reference assisted genome assembly. Reference genome means suppose we are sequencing a novel strain of MTB, Mycobacterium tuberculosis, then of course we have a reference, that is the RV strain of MTB, that is very famous and standard genome. Okay, so we can take the help of that reference genome. And if it is we isolate any bacteria from the novel bacteria, then we have to perform de novo genome assembly. That is the reference, in that case, reference will be not available. And then genome finishing, of course, the aligning contigs, scaffolds to related species, assembled genome visualization, gap filling by Sanger sequencing, that is the traditional sequencing. And then genome annotation, as I said, genome annotation by existing pipelines, genome annotation by different specific tools with existing data, manual annotation for a particular class of genes. Manual annotation means, suppose in a bacterium or a fungi, I am interested in a, suppose fungal genome, which is oil producing, the oligogenous yeast, suppose, then of course I will look for the genes involved in the pathway of oil production, right? Okay, so I'll perform some manual annotation for those genes, or I am interested in a bacteria, I'm interested in the nitroaromatic compound degrading genes, then of course I'll take those genes sequences from the NCBI or anywhere. And then I have to align those sequences to our annotated genome that we assembled here, right? Those and some manual annotations, as I showed. All right. So at the time, actually, the Burkholderia, we sequenced this Burkholderia genome, Burkholderia SP-SA98. Actually, in the wet lab, they said that the wet lab scientists isolate this bacteria from India, Assam agriculture fields, and they characterize this bacteria in the lab, in the petri plate, and they said that this bacteria can degrade nitroaromatic compounds, and this can be a very important tool for the nitroaromatic compound degradation in the environment. So these harmful chemicals can be degraded with the help of this Burkholderia. And then we sequenced this Burkholderia with the ROS 454 sequencing. I got reads, and then I used that Nubular Genome Assembler. Nubular is the best assembler for ROS 454 data. So currently, at this time, I don't know Nubular is available or not, but ROS 454 data, or our data, or Burkholderia data, you can freely download from NCBI. Okay. And then I assemble those reads to contigs. I got 79 contigs at that time. And as we know that bacteria have one chromosome, but this bacteria have three chromosomes actually, and three plasmid also. So ideally I would be getting six contigs, but of course, as I said, this assembly process is kind of random reads from the random reads. The assembly, we always have some gaps, So after that, on the basis of paired end information, I assembled those contigs into 17 scaffolds near to the six that I was expecting. And then further, we cannot, and then annotate those scaffolds. And this, again, the strategy. So in the 17 scaffolds, we had more than 58,000 Ns. Ns means, as I said, any nucleotide. We don't know. These are called gaps, actually. So with the help of Illumina sequencing, I filled the gaps, by gap closure tool. And then Separately, I also assembled these Illumina sequencing data separately in the form of contigs and then put the blast with against these 17 scaffolds. So, you know, gap closer reduced the gaps from 58,000 to 800. And then with the help of these contigs, again, 14 scaffolds finally we got with zero ends. And then we annotated these 14 scaffolds. And then, of course, after annotation, we got that this information, the first, the second column, Burkholderia SC98, and then I compared this bacteria with the related species like YI23, CCGE1001, CCGE1002, CCGE1003, you know, and then we found this YI23 is the closest neighbor of this, our bacteria. You know, the Burkholderia we did the de novo means the reference genome was not available, but you do, then we did some phylogenetic, phylogenomic information on the basis of that. We found that Burkholderia was neighboring species. And then we compared GC content, number of proteins, and all those different things. And here, number of QS. So, wet lab scientist told me that this Burkholderia have the chemotaxis property also. It means in a petri plate, if you put this the culture of this bacteria and like a few centimeter away, you put some compounds, then this will move towards the chemicals, basically nitroaromatic compound. It means this can move towards that, towards those chemicals to eat, to chop them, or I can say to digest them, basically nitroaromatic compound. So we found that 37, taxis genes in this Burkholderia, you know, as compared to the YI23, 25, and, as compared to E. coli have only 10. It means this Burkholderia adapt himself to eat those to degrade those nitroaromatic compounds, with some chemotaxis genes, this is the evolution. The comparison of chemotaxis gene clusters in Burkholderia. So neighboring species we compared, and we found this arrangement of the chemotaxis gene clusters, the genes that you can see in the legend. These are the chemotaxis genes. So approximately the same arrangement of chemotaxis genes in all the related species as the Burkholderia. And of course, we published this research. Give me a second. All right. So in the first paper, we published this genome as a draft, basically. In the second paper, we, perform the annotation with special focus on chemotaxis genes. So I was working with Surendra, of course. Dr. Raghava was he's in IIIT Delhi now. Dr. Raghava was our PhD advisor. So two papers, I did some bioinformatics first. In the third paper, Surendra take the lead, basically. He was involved in the wet lab experiment. So he proved that gene involved in the degradation of para-nitrophenols are differentially arranged. So he experimentally proved. So this is the first example, actually, with the help of next generation sequencing data, how you can produce a useful research. So, and then in the same line, I performed the 12 other bacterial genome draft with different scientists there at the time. And then this is also my first author paper here with another scientist, Dr. Alok Mandal. He is now at JNU. So he sequenced at the time at ImTech, he sequenced this Debreomyces hansenii yeast, basically. He said that this is involved in the salt tolerance. So this fungal genome was his interest. So I did this genome assembly annotation. And then, of course, Dr. Bachawat, now he's at ICER Mohali. So he, sequence this fungal genome, Rhodospodium torulovis, that is the oligogenous yeast, and here they sequence the transcriptome also and give it to me. Okay, so they said that why don't you annotate this genome with the transcriptome data. So we followed this pipeline, basically transcript genome assembly and genome assembly, transcriptome as well as genome assembly, and then filter the reads and of course the assembly of transcript and contigs, and then the transcript assisted genome annotation. So we published actually in the eukaryote cell both the first author such articles, and then I prepared this web-based website, or you can say database, of the Burkhardt area that we were doing. So you can go to this and find out some useful information about this bacterium, and all type of data sets are available here. So as I said, in the same line, I deal with the 17 genomes basically. So these 17 genomes data already available at this genomics web portal. It's there. You can find out the raw data, assembled data, annotated data of these 17, if somebody want to try basically. And I developed this pipeline also for learners. Like I was learning at the time, and for the young researchers, I developed this genotype pipeline for whole genome assembly annotation. I put three scripts here, the raw reads, to convert raw reads into filtered reads, and then filtered reads into the assembled genome, and then annotation. So it's like a pipeline, a small pipeline you can install from this website, or you can go to Dr. Raghava at IIIT Delhi and you can find out this tool. And now, after this, integration of next generation sequencing tools to the databases. So imagine, my other colleague, Dr. Rahul, now he's at ISC Bangalore. So he was developing this cancer drug resistant database. In this, basically, he was doing like a drug and target relationship, means the genes and their mutation and the drug relationship. They had some genes basically in which if the mutation happened, then we can say this caused cancer. And they asked me, why don't you use your tools to put here in our databases so that this can be give more scientific insight to the people, to the research community. And then I put this module map alignment basically. So I think that they already have the target genes in which, if it happened, then we can say this is leads to the cancer. Okay. And then I put this module map alignment. You can put the short reads of your newly sequenced genome. Suppose if a person have cancer, you can sequence his genome or transcriptome, and you can put those short reads, and then this will map to those short reads to the target genes. So we can easily identify the mutation in the patient. Like the target sequences, the normal human being sequences are there at this database. And if we sequence the cancer genome, then we can find out the mutation. I will show you the example, like alignment basically. Like suppose these are the cancer genes, I can say like normal genes, normal cancer genes. If mutation happened in these genes, we can say it leads to cancer. And then we can map these, short reads of cancer patients, and you can see like this one, for this particular gene, a cancer target, we have a mutation in the cancer patient. Like this is at this particular gene, at this particular position in cancer patient, we have G instead of A. We can say, okay, in this gene, this mutation is present. So this is the mutation founder. And of course, then on the basis of mutation, we can check the drug target relationship. So this is like a very small example I put here. And of course, you can put the contigs also at this cancer DR database, and that contigs, we can this module can predict the genes, and this can align the cancer genes, genes of the cancer patient to the normal genes basically, and find out the alignment or the mutation. And of course, the directly you can put the genes also, like genes from the annotated genome of a cancer patient to the normal human. And so you can easily find out that we use the BLAST here, and then we publish this in a cancer DR in Scientific Reports. And the same thing we did with pancreatic cancer methylation database. This is also an important resource, and we publish it. And of course, now the genomics data for human. So give me a minute, then we'll start. So genomics data for human. So for human, actually, like with the help of NGS datasets, we can perform the whole genome sequencing, RNA sequencing, exome capture, small RNA sequencing for non-coding RNA study, degradome sequencing, ChIP-seq for specific protein binding sites, genome-wide, HiSeq data for 3D architecture of the genome, and many more applications, So for exome sequencing, we have this pipeline. Like suppose we sequence the exome. Exome means the coding part of genome, only the coding. So basically medical genetics personals have this genome, gene panels basically. So they always sequence those particular set of genes in which they can easily find out the mutation, and they can predict the disease as with the help of this next generation sequencing technology. So in the first step, we have to filter those reads, of course. And for the first step, we have these tools, NGS QC toolkit, FastXQC, FastQC. And of course, then we have to align those filtered reads of the human genome. And then alignment of alignment file, the processing of the alignment file, detection of the SNPs and somatic variations, and then mutation calling, and of course then with the help of mutations, drug target relationship and disease prediction. So for all these steps, we have these tools, as I mentioned here, different tools. So I use the whole genome sequencing data basically for the 1000 genome project that is freely available at that time. And right now also, I think, so I analyze this 1000 genome project data, and then annotate the variations, and then publish and contribute a second paper, this one, the platform for designing genome-based personalized immunotherapy or vaccine against cancer. So this analysis is helpful, So what I did, I generated the different variants of all the proteins basically, like in 1000 genome, different variations are present in each gene. Suppose a gene A, we have multiple variants in different humans, So those kind of studies I performed and then contributed in this personalized immunotherapy or vaccine against cancer. So then, some novel molecules, as I said, there are after bacteria, human, and then some novel gene identification. So novel molecules, so fusion transcript. Fusion transcript is a very new concept, and this will be with the help of next generation sequencing. This is very helpful, to detect the fusions. And what are the fusions basically? Fusion of two transcripts. Fusion transcripts may be coding or non-coding. Sorry for the typo. Coding of non-coding is, it should be coding or non-coding. Traditionally detected in various tumors and stabilized as biomarkers. Biomarkers means like if this fusion is present, then we can say this person have this particular type of cancer. Like I am giving example of three BCR-ABL in chronic myelogenous leukemia and TMPRSS fusion in the prostate cancer. So, you know, different type of fusions, different type of cancer. But when I joined my postdoc at University of Virginia, USA, we found that the fusion transcripts also present in non-neoplastic tissues. Means fusion transcripts are also present in non-disease tissues. So now, of course, we have to filter out the fusion transcripts that are exclusively present in the cancers or disease conditions. So how this fusion form? Of course, at DNA level or RNA level. And at DNA level, we have translocation. You can see AB and then AB fusion. Insertion, you can see insertion, inversion, like AB fusion, and unbalanced rearrangement. That is the deletion, means this part is lost between A and B and AB fused. That is DNA level fusion. And at RNA level, basically, like suppose two genes are like far apart from the at DNA level, but two transcript, you know, generated from two different genes that may fuse together to form a novel transcript. That is trans-splicing, okay? And then cis-splicing, oh, means neighboring gene fusion like gene A and gene B are continuous in a chromosome, then of course the fusion transcript may happen, that is cis-splicing of the neighbor genes. So as a bioinformatician, I noticed that for the fusion transcript detection, you know, from RNA-seq data, RNA-seq data means transcript data, we had these tools. So, and these tools have their different algorithms, you know, and these tools have followed different strategies to for the identification of fusion. You know, before the lab validation, we have to identify fusions with the help of these tools, and then we have to be sure, like, okay, this fusion should be validated in the lab. So this will save our resources, our chemicals, our enzymes, all those things, you know, and money, of course. So as far as these tools are concerned, we put several questions in our, you know, thoughts, like which tool produces maximum true fusion, overlap between the result of different tools, which is taking less time, computational time, memory. Is there any detection in the data that does not have fusion? If yes, then which tool produces maximum false fusion, and different factors alter the fusion transcript detection. So any previous attempt, yes, somebody attempted in 2013, like compared only six tools, but at that time, actually in 2015-16, I had more than 30 tools actually. So what I did, as a positive, in one of the tool, FusionMap, they have some data, they said that these are simulated paired and RNA-seq reads that have 60,000 paired and reads of 70 nucleotide, and they have 50 fusions. And negative data means the RNA-seq data don't have any fusion. I mixed those data sets to make mixed data set, and our real data, real life data of the prostate cancer cell lines. So these data sets I took and then comparative assessment of methods for the fusion transcript detection from RNA-seq data. So I compared these two and then produced some results, you know, in 2015, they published this paper. So interestingly, the same, you know, published, you can see, Our paper published in October, you can see it right left hand side, October 2015, and the November 2015, we have this same research, comprehensive evaluation of fusion transcript detection algorithms and a metacolor to combine top performing method in paired and RNA-seq data. So the same kind of study basically, and that was my effort basically, and this is the effort from, you can see, different groups, international collaboration, different lots of people, and of course they published in Nucleic Acid Research, like far better journal than Scientific Reports. And so I read that paper actually, and find out they did nothing great, but you know, the some sophisticated analysis and more, you know, representation of data, like more data sets they took as compared to us, and like a more sophisticated representation of the data. And I noticed that they took the normal human being data and they considered as negative data actually. So they were thinking that this fusion transcripts only present in the case of cancers basically, and the negative data set means the normal human don't have the fusions. But at the same time, as a postdoc, I was like handling the normal human being data and found lots of fusions in the normal human being. So I questioned this basically, that the normal fusions, normal human also have fusions. And then I wrote a review, you know. So here I discussed the fusion genes, identification, importance, fusion finders, mechanism, comparison, future, benchmarking studies, pros and cons. I put that point here, pros and cons, importance, fusion direction, tool development, data type, and all those things, you know. So you can easily find this paper at my website. So then the reviewer, you know, reviewer and the editor was happy, and they gave the opportunity to make a cover image of that issue of this journal via RNA. And then I produced this cover image. Actually, it is nothing, but you can see at left hand side, we have the neighboring representation of the on the human chromosome, the representation of neighboring gene fusion. And at the bottom, we have the fusion from different genes at different chromosomes. And the upper right hand side is the mixture of all this data. So this is, that was the cover image. And as I said, I was dealing with the normal human being data. So from this paper, you can see the they did tissue-specific gene genome-wide integration, transcriptome, and transcriptome studies. We took this data. We took this data from this paper and identify the fusion. So this is the reuse of data, basically. That's very important in the biological science, where people are using lots of money, utilizing lots of money for the sequencing. Here, we used the already sequenced data, that people did something and we did something with these data sets, you know, to save our money, but new information, different kind of information from the same data, you know. So we identify the fusions, and this is the representation of the fusions in normal human being from this paper. So this is the like some attractive graphs, like different fusions in mental tissues, you know. And as I said, the Sarcos plot, different type of fusions. You can see the cis fusion and trans fusions means the neighboring gene fusions and the fusions at fusions of the genes from different and chromosomes, you know. And of course, these some kind of fusions. So, and then, excuse me. So now we proposed, on the basis of the fusion data, we proposed that this is the expression-based clustering of the tissues. And this is at the down, at the bottom, we have fusion-based clustering. We said that that the gene expression can change with time, with temperature and other factors. Like suppose I have to start like running, then lots of my gene expression, you know, change with, quickly change with running, or, you know, different with different emotions or different activities. But this fusion cannot change actually so rapidly. Fusion take lots of time to formation. So we said that this fusion-based clustering is more reliable as compared to the expression-based clustering. This is just like a hypothesis, but of course we have to validate those things. And then we correlate with this fusion data with the phenotypic data, like chimeric fusions, RNA, non-cancer tissues, and cell, you know, the second one, absence of correlation between chimeric RNA and aging. So we compared this fusion data with the phenotypic data. And for aging, we also experimentally validate something with the help of Raina Hung, and then we published it. So these things, you know, and then I personally analyzed more than 10,000 of RNA sequencing data sets of normal human beings from this GTEC portal, and then useful information that is like a publication in NAR. So this is a reputed journal. You can go and you can check the landscape of chimeric RNA in known diseased tissue and cells. So, and of course, not only the normal human being, but of course the different cancer tissues, we publish this fusion transcript, you know, identification data sets in alveolar rhabdosarcoma and cervical cancer. Now, after my postdoc, I came here at NIPGR where I have to deal with the plants. So I started thinking about plants here. In 2017, I joined the institute, and in the 4 years, right now, we developed several databases and of course a tool, you know, software package and some useful studies as far as these novel molecules are concerned. So fusion transcript, let me tell you first, why we will need the fusion transcript in plants. To understand the mechanism of fusion formation in plants, evolutionary genomics, actually, and the role of species and stage-specific fusion transcripts in plants, role of fusion genes in secondary metabolite synthesis, role of fusion genes in immunity, and of course, non-coding fusion transcripts. Non-coding means that means if it is coding, if the fusion transcript is coding, means it will code for a protein, and then protein may compete with the proteins that coded by parental genes, and may alter them or may alter their activity or may perform different function. And if the fusion transcript is non-coding, then that may act as long non-coding RNA. So this is very interesting. So to start with, we took the Arabidopsis. As I said, we always use the freely available data sets. You know, we took the several thousands of Arabidopsis thaliana paired and RNA-seq data. And then we use this AriScript tool, AriScript plant, and then we took some fusions and correlates these fusion transcripts with the phenotypic data of plant. Phenotypic means tissue-wise, stress-wise, like leaf, root, shoot, and different things. And you know, and then we developed this AT fusion database. As you can see, NCBI SRA data, and then AT fusion database, we have these different tools also, and major fields we have expression, fusion type, and UniProt ID. And you must explore this if you are interested, this AT fusion DB, which is the paper we published. And then identification and characterization of small RNAs in plants. So we wrote a review basically, where in the briefings in bioinformatics, we start learning with these small RNA identification. After long non-coding RNA, small RNA also, major endogenous regulatory non-coding RNA in plants, prospective classification of plant regulatory non-coding RNAs based on size distribution. Plant non-coding RNAs can be grouped into three major ncRNAs, namely small RNA, LNCRNA, and circular RNA. So small RNA sequencing, you know, produce these microRNAs, different type of tRNA fragments, and RNA-seq produce the long non-coding RNA, circular RNA. And if the size is concerned, then we have these on the basis of size, we have 20 to 24 nucleotides, TASI RNA and microRNA, and of course 15 to 42 nucleotide tRNA fragments, this is our area of interest, tRNA fragments that may act as the genome regulators basically, as like a microRNAs. And then more than 200 nucleotide length LNCRNA, and of course more than 100 nucleotide length circular RNA. So these are the like I'm skipping these slides. You must go to this review article. This is important. You can note down these computational methods for annotation of the plant regulatory non-coding RNA, then you can easily find out the information related to those different type of non-coding RNAs that we put in this review article. Very nice article. People appreciated this effort actually. So after that, as I said, our interest is like transfer RNA derived fragments, you know. Now we started this TRFs basically to study these small RNAs in plants. After that, fusion transcript and long non-coding RNAs. So as you can see, these TRFs are three types. Like TRF1 from the premature tRNA, pre-tRNA, I can say. And from the mature tRNA, we have at like at 5' end, we have TRF5, and 3' end, we have TRF3. So tRNA break into the pieces enzymatically, not randomly, and produce these tRNA halves and TRFs. So this is not random cleavage. Of course, we proved our analysis. We proved in our analysis, this is not randomly, not random cleavage. It's not like a random degradation, but in different stress conditions, plant produce these tRNA fragments and different enzymes are involved actually. Let me go one by one in this. So TRFs are like 15 to 28 nucleotide length tRNA fragments that is TRF1, 5, and 3. They are not byproduct of tRNA degradation. This is already known in Trans 17 paper. All tRNA do not produce 3 TRFs, and not all TRFs are equally abundant. They detected in diverse species from archaebacteria to human and plants as well. Multiple role of TRFs in different organisms. Multiple role means they act at like microRNA, they act at like transcription, but as well as at translation level. And in human, both dicer dependent means like microRNA, they can follow the dicer dependent and dicer independent pathways for the TRF generation. And if we talk about the plants, we have like exact mechanism of TRF generation is not elucidated. Overaction of TRFs during oxidative stress and phosphate deficit conditions already known. Overexpression in different biotic and abiotic stress conditions in barley, rice, pumpkin, apple, soybean, pepper. This information from different research articles, like some research group published in barley, some research group published in rice, someone published in pumpkin, and Indian scientists published in pepper, you know, from the south. One research article came in Frontiers, they published in pepper, of course, in apple, soybean. So different research articles from different research groups. In aerodopsis, not only DCL, but ribonucleic RNase-1, ribonucleic RNase-1 is involved in the TRF generation. This is known. Classical dicer-dependent pathway cannot be ruled out. It means they follow the both, like microRNA, dicer-dependent, like microRNA, and dicer-independent pathway also. TRF bind with agoproteins involved in the transcription repression. Interface with the ribosomal activity and depresses translation. So initially we followed this methodology. Like here, we took more than 1,000 of small RNA sequencing data of 10 plant species, tRNA gene sets, blast and further analysis, assignment of tRNA type, and we got these entries. So initially we were studying this TRF531 means TRFs only, and publish this database. This is PTRFTB, plant transfer RNA derived fragments database. And then we published it as a database. Then we improved our methodology. Here at the right hand side figure B, you can see this is the different representation here from the tRNA, from the precursor tRNA or pre-tRNA. We will be having TRF1, like from 3' end. From 5' end, we will have leaders TRF. From mature tRNA, from 3' end, we will have this TRF3. And from 5' end, we will have like TRF5. And of course, from mature tRNA, like tRNA half actually, a different representation from the previous picture. And now we improved our methodology actually. We have, we took the genome. From the genome, we took the tRNA genes and the mask genome also. And then we use this sophisticated pipeline. You don't need to go into this pipeline, but actually you can use it directly. We published as a database. So identification of tncRNA is a workflow from the identification of various classes of tncRNA. tncRNA means transfer RNA drive non-coding RNAs, because now we are including all, not only the TRFs, but the tRNA halves as well. And then this pipeline, basically pipeline for the tRNA identification, we have genome, tRNA genes, high confidence tRNA, and then tncRNAs. And we use more than 2,500 small RNA sequencing data set from 6 plants. And then we, with this improved pipeline, we have you in these informations, tncRNA information, right? So this is interesting actually. One by one, I'll tell you. With this paper we published recently, you can see this a picture. This is very clear. And in B, we are saying that this is a circles plot of Arabidopsis thaliana. The innermost circle, the tRNA gene, and the first, you know, from inside, the first circle, second circle, third circle, fourth, these are different TRF and TRF like tRNA halves actually. So here we are saying that the region, the genomic region have high tRNA number does not necessarily produce the high number of tRNA fragment, and vice versa. It means the genomic region where the tRNA genes are present in high number, we cannot say that TRFs will be produced in high number. You can see this blue one, the blue one in the inner circle, this is like high, you know, high number of tRNA genes, but you can see as compared to this blue one, low number of tRNA fragments. It means in the genome, this is not depend upon the tRNA copy. It means it is the tRNA the specific, only the specific tRNAs chop, or I can say the produce the TRFs. Or and then this is the C. In C, you can see for TRF5, I am giving example of TRF5. In all 6 plants like Arabidopsis, Sizer, Medicago, Oryza, Solanum, Siamese, we found in, we took the 3 most prominent TRFs actually. And if you see the first row, this one, you can see a specific pattern we found in the TRF5 sequences. It means this is not a random degradation of tRNA. Means there are some specific sites only where enzyme cleave the tRNA genes and produce this TRF5. That is very clear. And in the D picture, this is the correlation between the, at x-axis we have per tRNA gene copy, at y-axis we have tncRNAs log to value. So here the number of tRNA copies have slightly positive correlation, not highly correlated, slightly positive correlation with the number of tncRNA generated. It means in all 6 plants with the data, we can say that if the high copy number of tRNA present does not mean it will produce the high number of tncRNA. These are different conclusions and published in Computational and Structural Biotechnology Journal. And of course, a different type of analysis that I'm not showing in this picture. In this here, another picture. So from the same paper, So inference of this picture is, first, we all know that there are 61 coding anticodon tRNA that code for protein. And here you can see not all 61, but actually in Arabidopsis 49, in chickpea 41, medicago 44, and tomato, rice, and maize 48 anticodon tRNA only produce the TRFs. It means the rest, like suppose in Arabidopsis only 49, not all 61 coding tRNAs, you know, produce TRF. So that is one thing. Second inference is, although code for the same amino acid like tRNA, arginine, have anticodon like ACG, ACG, CCG, GGT, TG, TCG, TCT, not all the isoacceptors produce the TRFs, but actually the specific isoacceptor for example, tRNA arginine, I am giving you the example, only tRNA arginine, ACG, produce most of the TRF5. So all the code for the same amino acid, but not necessarily all the isoacceptor produce the TRFs. And different type of expression of the isoacceptor wise, different type of expression of the production of the TRFs in different plants. Okay, so there is no pattern here. So we can say only specific type of, in each plant, only specific type of isoacceptor produce the TRFs. And of course, this is the relationship like the TRF, we also predicted the TRF targets basically. And then we have these graphs, you know, the TRF target these genes which are responsible in the transferase activity, catalytic activity, cellular process, and all those sophisticated things. So you can go to the paper actually to understand. And of course, this is the distribution, T distribution, Disney plot to visualize the tissue specific TNCRN expression, Arabidopsis, and all those, you know. As you can see, the first right left hand side first graph, you can see for the 5' tRNA half, we have these clusters, basically tissue wise clusters. It means they are like tissue specific. And then we developed this tRNA plant tRNA database also. And then, of course, a different type of research are also going in our lab, like viral derived. VSRNAs in plants, like imagine, like suppose virus, if a virus attack on the plant, then with the help of different proteins in the plant from the viral genome itself, the VSIRNA is produced, and these VSIRNA with the help of agglutinin and all the other complex, they inhibit the viral genome by RISC complex actually. It means from the same virus, VSIRNAs with the help of host proteins alter the viral infection or inhibit the viral genome, I can say. These are the VSIRNAs, and then we study these VSIRNAs and different analyses and identification of viral driver siRNA. We develop this pipeline. We study this pipeline, and of course, we catalog these tools for the VSIRNA identification, and we developed this database, VSIRNA database, and we wrote this review also, from current knowledge to best practice, a primer for viral diagnosis using deep sequencing viral derived small RNAs in plants. And of course, we developed this, we are working on the plant therapeutic peptides also. And then we have different, you know, plant-derived peptides with the different kind of activities, therapeutic activities mainly. And then we collect the data from different, you know, the databases, and we made a database here and published this database. So that's about my, you know, whole work related to the, you know, the NGS data sets. And you can see, acknowledgement, Professor GPS Raghava from IMTech Chandigarh, now at IIIT Delhi, Professor Hui Li from University of Virginia, Charlottesville, and my lab members at NIPGR. So it's all about my presentation. Thank you very much for your kind attention. And this is my email ID, actually. If you have any question or concern, then I am very happy to answer your queries at shailesh@nipgr.ac.in. Let me share you again this one. All right. So this is the email ID, shailesh@nipgr.ac.in. So it's all about my presentation. And now I'm happy to answer the queries.
Thank you so much, sir. A really informative session. And now I request the participants, please, you can put your queries in the chat box, or you can ask by yourself. You can unmute yourself. We are open for questions. Yes, you can put your question in the chat box. No questions. I guess you people are able to unmute yourself. If not, then you can put it in chat. So we have a question.
Yes, please ask.
So, that is about next generation sequencing.
Mm-hmm.
So which technology do you think is most suitable if you want to go for next generation sequencing?
So it depends upon the application. Like if you are dealing with the whole genome assembly, then you must go for Helloscope, PacBio Nanopore. But if you are like, this is too expensive, PacBio Nanopore is still expensive. But if you are going for transcriptome, you can adopt the Illumina sequencing.
Okay, sir. And we were going through different softwares which you have contributed under Dr. Raghav in MTech. So can you just tell us which of them are free tools or softwares which we can use for computer-aided drug designing?
So they are all free, actually. There is nothing paid from Indian researchers like Dr. Raghava or me. They are all free.
Okay, sir. So any particular tools for this computer-aided drug designing?
Yeah, definitely you can go to the website, basically Dr. Raghava's website. You can just Google it and then you will find, Dr. GPS Raghava at IIIT. And then you can easily find lots of tools are there.
Okay, sir. Anyone is having any more question? Yes. So one more question is there that basically we people are mostly we are academicians. We are teaching in these institutes. So if we want to go ahead with something, a project for our students under next generation sequencing, so what protocol we can follow if we want to go for this NGS, so which labs we can approach for the same?
Okay, so basically as far as this analysis is concerned, you can you know, we can you, I can we take some students, we can take some students also, no problem. But like there are several workshops and you know some those things are going on. Let me put something in your chat that you can use this basically. Like I put a link here, you can follow this. This is good platform actually. I found this very good.
Okay, sir.
So yeah, so I just put it here. Yeah, so nextgenhelper.com, and then you can explore this platform. And for the training, basically students training, you know, like we can take one or two students, depends upon the choice, you know, the enthusiasm of the students. So that can be done. But these people actually are like dealing with all the teaching all the NGS data sets on the regular basis actually. So the people can go to this website and just register for the upcoming sessions.
This is open for faculty members as well.
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
Because sometimes they're not into much into the practical thing related to this next generation sequencing. So I guess this can be helpful for all.
Yeah, yeah. They will teach you the you know, real life data handling actually. Yeah, like all my friends basically, colleagues, I can say, yeah.
Okay.
They develop this platform.
So there is one more question. Does the database developed by you can help in characterizing plant miRNA also?
For characterization of microRNAs, actually, you have to search a good tool basically. And for the characterization, they are mainly databases. And if you are talking about my tool, that is pncRNA tool, that is specific for the tRNA derived fragments because it's kind of a new research. But of course, we can discuss, you know, it will take some tools, some time to understand the exact, you know, exact research, what we want to do with the characterization of microRNAs. So it will take, you know, some time, you know, some tools that, but currently I don't have anything like characterization of microRNAs. The people developed already several things.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
So, one last question I want to ask.
Mm-hmm.
You had mentioned about various tools under bioinformatics, which you and the team had developed. So, what being from a background of biotech or from bioinformatics, so what about the coding part or the development part of the software or the tool? Is there any kind of a back-end team that is working for this, or you people are only involved?
Actually, frankly speaking, like I did my master's from School of Life Sciences, JNU, and I was doing like protein biochemistry and all those things, you know. So I start learning myself in PhD, and currently I have students like they are like MSc Botany, MSc Biotechnology, MSc Life Sciences, and in the PhD they always learn themselves. Actually, self-learning is like important thing here. But of course, we will be having trained persons in the coding part from IIT, IIT Delhi, or different IITs, or maybe, you know, some the students that have masters in computational biology or computer science, they may be useful. But right now, currently, I did myself, you know, learning this coding. My students are also learning in the lab. So there is no backend kind of like support. We are all doing ourselves actually. The website, the databases, the coding we are doing, they are like the practice in the PhD tenure.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much. Any more questions anyone wants to ask? I guess that's enough. So really thankful, sir. First of all, for accepting my invitation. And next is, it was a wonderful session, and I really got to know what all work you have done with your team. And it is really good because many of the tools which you have mentioned today, I also had used the same tools for my project as well as for training my students. So So now I would like to request Dr. Deepa to please extend vote of thanks to Dr. Sailesh. So please.
Good morning, sir. So I will really appreciate the way you talk about the microbial gene assembly and annotation and different type of database that are used. It was a very informative session for all the people who attended it, and we recorded it and we try to put it on some platform so it will be shared to many people. So I would like to thanks again Dr. Sailesh for a wonderful session. Thank you, sir.
All right, thanks for the invitation. And thank you all of you for your
thank
patience.
You so much,
all
thank
right.
You, thank you very much.
We'll be in. I'll be sharing your contact details with the participants because I think there is a lot which you can just share with us, and you can just guide us with various bioinformatics tools and various areas in this bioinformatics. So I think many of the participants will be approaching you and me as well, because I think there are various tools which I can use for my work, and I can just help my students with your approach for bioinformatics. Thank you once again, sir, for accepting this invitation.
All right. Thank you. So may I leave now?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
All right. Great.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you all. Bye.
Okay, so participants, we'll just come again at around 12, and the next session is on protein structure and applications in drug discovery. That will be delivered by Dr. Nagendra Singh. So please do join at around 11:55, and I had shared the attendance link right now on the chat box as well as in the WhatsApp group, so you can fill the attendance for this session. Thank you all. Yes, you need to come back at 11:55. I'm just going to end the session. If you have filled the attendance, then it's well and good. If not, then you can go to the WhatsApp group. I'm just posting the same link on the WhatsApp group as well. You can come back around 11:55.